I am privileged to be here on the same stage as the author, because I've known him for quite some time now. He lives in a lovely house in Princeton, which is the area where the famous University of Princeton is also. His biography was not read out, but let me briefly tell you that he was a senior or a group president, a vice president of a very famous corporation called the ITT. He's an electronics engineer, made a lot of money, and at the young age of 44, I think, he thought that he had made enough money, and he created some trusts so that his wife doesn't get the feeling where the next meal is going to come from, and for his children, and just quit the job, which no one in his right mind would have done at that stage. And therefore, he devoted himself to a cultural renaissance by writing books which are different from what you are being prescribed as textbooks. I've been urging him to write an alternative history of India. I said, one of these days our government will come and we will prescribe it as a text. Because much of the problem concerned with breaking of India is because the Indians have not been brought up on a clear concept of identity. In most of the important countries of the world, the first thing that is dimmed into the mind of the citizen is his identity. Sometimes the formulation of identity is such that you know that it can't apply to everybody, but still they say the identity of nation is this. For example, Samuel Huntington wrote a book called Who We Are. And he says that America's identity is white, Anglo-Saxon, Protestant, Christian, speaking English. Now we know there's a very big segment which is not white, which is not Protestant, which is not even English speaking. There are a lot of Spanish speaking people who don't speak English. But he argued, and it has been accepted, that that is the identity of America. And it describes the parameters with which Americans are to function. So if I ask an Indian, what is the identity of Indian? After much persuasion, the only answer I get is, I have an Indian passport. That is not an Indian. What about the past? What is your connection with the past? There the problem arises, because if you say your past is a Hindu past, then what about the Muslims and the Christians? How do you fit them in? So I'd like to say that in order to analyze what are the forces breaking India, we must first know the cause, and then we must briefly describe the cure. When India became independent in 47, Churchill said, within 3 years, India will break up. In 1967, Nixon wrote a book saying India will break up into 20 countries. The Chinese, whom I know well, and I've been many times to China, they told me in 1962 they were sure that India will break up into several countries after the defeat, because it was an artificial union. Many Indians think that India was created by the British, by the Act of 1947, which is called the Indian Independence Act. So therefore, we need a counter intellectual movement. much like Vishwamitra, who was not given entry into the heavens. So he created a counter heaven, a counter universe, till the gods got scared and then told him that we accept you. I think today in our modern India, we have a new Vishwamitra in making. He's Rajiv Malhotra. Because I've read his books, I've stayed with him in his lovely house, and I find that he's only devoted to this work. He has no other interests. Of course, he's made a lot of money, but he has put that money to good use. The British created this Dravidian movement. The British fostered it, financed it, without, and through the English education made sure that you never knew what the origin of the word Dravidian is. Dravidian word is not a Tamil word. Dravidian word is a Sanskrit word, which was invented by or first publicized by Adi Shankara when he went to Varanasi to debate Mandara Mishra. You know the Hindu tradition, which is also the Buddhist tradition, Uttaramimsa school tradition, that you could convert somebody individually to your religion if you had a discussion and defeated them in that discussion. That's called Shastrat. And so Shankara went all over the country holding these debates, winning at every place. But the greatest spokesman of Uttaramimsa school was Mandara Mishra in Varanasi. And he challenged him. Now, challenged to a debate, he accepted it, but the question was, who's going to be the umpire? So finally, because one is the greatest spokesman of Hinduism at that time, and the other was the greatest spokesman of Buddhist way of thinking or Uttaramimsa school. And so who will be the umpire? So finally, it was decided that Mandana Mishra's wife will be the umpire. That was his first mistake. Because the wife knows too much about the husband, so she's not going to ever declare him a winner. In fact, Mandana Mishra lost the debate. First question his wife asked Shankara, "Who are you?" He said, "I'm Dravida Shishu." Shishu means child. What is Dravida? Explained, it's a sandhi of two words, thra and vit. Essentially translated means where the three coasts meet or the three oceans meet. So it was a regional term. But the British made it into a racial term. And this racial term led to even the divisions in interpretation of Ramayana. That Ravan was Dravida and Ram was Arya. The word Aryan doesn't exist in Sanskrit literature. Arya exists, means a cultured noble person. And in Tamil we say Aya. Every word we have some similar word. But Ravan was not even a Dravidian in that sense. He was not even a regionally a South Indian. Because he was born in Noida, which is just on the border of Delhi. His wife Mandutri was born in Meerut. He came to know about Guber and Sri Lanka. So he went and conquered Sri Lanka. And after that he was constantly trying to conquer Ayodhya. So therefore there was no such concept. How, on what basis the British created this? All on artificial basis. Color, skin color has got nothing to do with race. It has got to do with pigmentation. Michael Jackson proved it by taking out his pigmentation, he began looking like a white man. Race is decided by DNA. Can you produce a single study in this country or in the world which says that the Indian DNA between North and South is different? It's the same. Recently, the University of Cambridge has come out with a study. The University of Texas in Houston, the University of Houston University. They've all come out with studies that the DNA of Indian is the same. But for years and years, and even now, this Aryan Dravidian theory is being used. That a group of people, the whole of India was being ruled by Dravidians. Then the Aryans came from Khyber Pass. They were brutal people. They drove the Dravidians to the south, created this. This has to be demolished. It's being slowly demolished. I found in one debate I had, not one debate, newspaper exchange, in the Hindu newspaper, for some reason unknown to anybody, including myself, Ram and I are very good friends. So if I give anything to publish, he publishes it. So Romila Thapar wrote an article about India's secularism. And there she says that she's not an adherent to the Aryan Dravidian theory. Took me by surprise, because for years she has been propagating this Aryan Dravidian theory, even to the extent of saying that Ashoka was a Greek. That when Alexander came to India and conquered India, he fathered the grandfather of Ashoka. Now, of course, now she can't say that, but she's given it up. Slowly that thing is cracking. But we need a death blow. So I think the next article should be, the next book of yours should be the Aryan Dravidian theory. But it needs to be demolished completely. In fact, some little work I had done myself. I persuaded Karunanidhi to stop celebrating Ravan as Ravan Leela. Because I explained to him that both in Valmiki Ramayana and in Kamban Ramayana, Ravan was a Brahmin. I have seen this myself in terms of in actual experience when I got the Chinese, persuaded Chinese to reopen Kailash Mansarovar. I went as the first traveler to Kailash. On the way to Mansarovar, I saw there was a huge lake, which I had never heard about. So I asked the guide, what lake is this? He says it is called Ravan Haranga, sometimes called Rakshastal. So I said, why is it called Ravan? What is Haranga? Haranga's Sarovar, lake. But what, why Ravan? He said, no, somebody from India came here and he meditated here. So I said, in that case, let me go and have a bath first there and then I will go to Mansarovar. She said, no, if you have a bath there, you will get itches all over your body. If you drink the water, you will die. So of course, I filled a bottle of water and came back and gave it to Karunanidhi and said, please drink it and show me. Now the Dravida movement used to name their sons as Ravanan. Not anymore. But now, I mean, you can find many middle-aged and old-aged people who got the name Ravanan. So this is the extent it went to. And sometimes it became pathetic. The leader of the Dravidian movement, E.V. Ramaswamy Nayakar, E.V. Ramaswamy Nayakar, he wrote a letter in 1944, which I got a copy of, in which he is pleading with Jinnah to include in the creation of Pakistan an independent Dravidistan. And Jinnah, as a convinced Aryan, says, Dravida, you have nothing in common with us. You must fight for yourself. It's a pathetic letter. The same E.V. Ramaswamy Nayakar went on 15th August 1947 to the governor of Madras and said, let the British go from anywhere in India, but in Tamil Nadu, please do not leave. We need you. We want to work under you. We want to serve you. Of course, the British by then had given up hope and they didn't listen. So I am saying today, that we must adopt an idea and a concept of an identity of an Indian. If you read the literature of Al-Qaeda, or for matter the secret research is going on in Saudi Arabia, and I came to know this because I had a Saudi Arabian student in my class at Harvard, who one day came to ask me that I have been asked to ask you a question, which is not connected with the course. So I said, you ask me after the class is over. So he asked me that we are studying this question, that when Islam went to Iran and it was being ruled by Zoroastrians, it was 100% Zoroastrian country, within 15 years of the conquest of Iran, Iran was converted to 100% Islam. Neighborhood, which is called Babylon and Mesopotamia, they, after takeover by Islam, they converted them in 17 years to Islam, 100% Islam. The same thing with Egypt, 21 years, 100% Islam. The Christians went to Europe, and they converted Europe to 100% Christian in 50 years. But in India, 800 years of Islamic rule, 200 years of Christian rule, and you're still 83%. He says, you can't understand. And the reason is that Indians kept, or Hindus, kept fighting. And it's not that the Muslims didn't join. In fact, Shivaji had a Muslim general there. Oh, and there were Hindus in Aurangzeb's army also. But those are exceptions. But the Hindus fought. And the most glorious empire we produced for 350 years was born in Karnataka. The Vijayanagaram Empire, founded in Hampi, Hastinapur. By the way, Mandara Mishra, after he converted to Hinduism, Adi Shankara appointed him as the first Shankaracharya of Sringeri. So Sringeri Ashram began with that. And one of the successor Sringeri Acharyas, they created Vijayanagaram Empire on the basis of two young Muslim boys who were reconverted to Hinduism. Hukka and Bukka or something like that. It lasted 350 years. It spread right up to Assam. It covered more territory than Mughal rule ever. And Mughal rule, really the core Mughal rule was from Akbar to Aurangzeb. It's 150 years only. But you see the history books, one chapter for each Mughal emperor. But Vijayanagaram Empire, one paragraph. In South India, there was an empire called Vijayanagaram Empire. North Indians, even today, do not know Vijayanagaram Empire. So we need a new history book to tell you your identity. And they were fighting, fighting, fighting. What about Guru Gobind Singh? What about the sacrifice of Guru Tegh Bahadur? So these are the things that have to be brought into a book. I mean, I'm very happy about the book he's written about Breaking India, because I'm a Tamilian. And as a Tamilian, I've been fighting this Dravidian movement from day one. Most other anti-Dravidian people are too afraid to fight them because they are a bit violent. But then I know how to take care of violent people also. I have taken care of the LTT in no time, when I was minister and knocked them out of India. And later on marshaled international forces to see that that fellow doesn't survive, despite the best efforts of the government of India to save them. Nevertheless, I am saying today to you, first of all, this is first point. Second point is this Hindu lack of self-esteem. He becomes very, very diffident. Moment you say Hindu, oh no, see, I am not communal, please don't involve me in all this. I am not saying that you, I am saying how Hindus can improve himself, how does that become communal? I can understand if I am saying Hindus must kill Muslims, Hindus must make Christians as slaves, that is communal. But if I am saying there is something wrong with us, that we are not able to bond together, we come together. For example, Kumbh Mela will come together, 1 crore people will come. Government will not invite them, nobody will invite them. They'll come themselves, behave very well, there'll be hardly any crime in Kumbh Mela, and then they will disperse. Because all of them have an individual relationship with God. They say, please, my promotion is blocked, so I've come on this yatra, please see my promotion is, and back. There's no concern that 500,000 Kashmiri Pandits have been driven out from Kashmir. There's no concern that Bangladesh was 32% Hindu in 1947, today it is 7%. There's no concern that every day Hindu temples, ancient Hindu temples are being demolished in Kazakhstan and Guyana. We feel ourselves as individuals. This collective consciousness is not there because we lack self-esteem. We got wrong notions of our history. We didn't lose to foreigners because we were inferior. We lost because our rules were too civilized. We had a first rule was no fighting till the sun rises. And once the sun sets, go back to your tent and go and have a sleep. And come back the next day when the sun rises. No fighting in the villages or the towns or in the agricultural field. Fighting must be in the open maidan only, where minimum damage is caused to the civilians. And third is that if you after get defeated, if you defeat the enemy and he apologizes, then you forgive him and send him back. So Prithviraj Chauhan sent back Muhammad Ghori 716 times. That was too much. 2 times, okay, but 16 times? And the 17th time, he got the support of his father-in-law, and therefore he won. And the first person, and that's how Islam came to India. So these civilized rules were not appropriate for these people who came in the night, who went into the cities and rampaged it, who didn't observe any of the rules, and if you defeated them and they apologized, they came back. Each time, by the way, Ghori apologized. But he came back. So therefore, those rules are the correct. Today also the same thing. This is what he's brought out very brilliantly, Rajiv Malhotra. The rules of discourse are such that if you don't understand, you can't defeat them. Why is Mr. Rajiv Malhotra considered a dangerous man today in the United States by the left-wing intellectuals and the India, what they call India scholars or South Asian scholars? They don't even want to call themselves Indian scholars, they call themselves South Asian scholars. What is the history of South Asia except Indian history? So, this is because he speaks in their idiom and their articulation and defeats them. If he was a raving fanatic, then they would just say he's a fanatic and dismiss him. But he comes with all the credentials that they have or would like to have, and he argues in the idiom which they understand. And therefore, if there's an unbiased crowd such as the students, they get confused. And that's why today I think there is a process of begun to somehow accommodate him. His books are being prescribed in university. But I know him, he's not going to melt. He's come with a mission and we will take it forward. I have 2 more things to tell you. First is that breaking India is also being done through reservations. I am totally in favor of reservations for scheduled caste and scheduled tribes. But I can't see why anybody else should get reservations. Because reservations should be given to only those sections of society who have never been ruling classes in our country. Just because they are poor doesn't mean they should get reservations. The Brahmins are poor, do they get reservations? A lot of rural Kshatriyas are poor, do they get reservations? So the same way Yadavas were also kings. In fact, in Dwarka they were ruling for a long time till Krishna had them finished off. Jats have been ruling Delhi. Why is this ruling? And Muslims ruled for 800 years and today they want reservations. If there's anybody who should get reservations and preference to Muslims, is the Hindu who was persecuted all these 800 years. He is the one who deserves the reservations. Christians are ruling classes. Why should they get reservations? And where does this definition of minority come on the basis of religion? Is there any country in the world they can show that minority is a religion? The United Nations had collected from all countries of the world what is the status of minorities. Thailand, countries of Latin America all wrote saying we have no minorities. Now can you believe Brazil writing that we have no minorities? There were so many minorities. Because they say minority is only that group which is ethnically different. So Muslims are not ethnically different. They are all descended from Hindus only. Christians are not ethnically different. Scheduled caste I don't consider as minorities anyway. They are part of the Hindu community, but we exploited them. And therefore we have to make good for what they have suffered. Of course, as they join the mainstream, we should love them. And we should go on co-opting them. Ambedkar is an example who should be called a Maharishi or a Brahmin. He should not be called a scheduled caste because he was a scholar. He went in 1915 to Columbia University, wrote a wonderful thesis on economics, PhD. But at the same time in seminars he was writing about the cultural unity of India. He says there is no country in the world which is culturally one as India is. But Jawaharlal Nehru was a bit jealous of him because Jawaharlal Nehru used the word Pandit for himself after failing in all exams. And he saw this Ambedkar with PhD and a law degree and from Columbia and from London School. So he felt jealous, like he felt jealous about Subhash Chandra Bose. So he cornered him. Do you know that Ambedkar lost his deposit in three successive Lok Sabha elections in Maharashtra? Because Nehru saw to it that he would lose the amount of money he spent. And he became bitter in the end. But even then he converted only to Buddhism. He was being pursued by the Christian lobbies and the Muslim lobbies to convert to their religion, but he said no. And he became a Buddhist. It was the Janata government which then gave him Bharat Ratna. He was denied Bharat Ratna. So this reservation is another method of dividing India. Caste was a wrong word, as Rajiv Malhotra has mentioned it several times. It's a Portuguese word from the word costos. We have varna and jati. Jati is connected with family and blood lineage. But varna, which is fourfold, has nothing to do with birth. Two Maharishis, Bhrigu and Bhardwaja, decided that this, for a stable society, the power should be decentralized. And Bhrigu said there are four sources of power: knowledge, weapons, wealth and land. And he said no one person should have more than one of this. So if you have knowledge, if you are specialized in knowledge, you will not have weapons, you will not have wealth, you will not have land. And he said they should be venerated. They were called Brahmins. And it was not necessary that you should be born in a Brahmin family, nor it was a disqualification. Vedavyasa was born, his mother was a fisherwoman. He was called Maharishi, he wrote the Mahabharata. Valmiki was born of people who had been pushed out of the society. They were called untouchables in English. But his parents were Dalits. But he became a Maharishi and wrote the Ramayana. Same thing with Kalidasa. He was a hunter. He came from a family of hunters and he became the greatest poet India has produced. Vishwamitra was not a Brahmin at all. He was called the Rishi of Rishis. Even the gods bowed before him. But his parents were Kshatriyas. Ravan, as I told you, was a Brahmin. And you call him Dravida. When Ramayana describes when Ravan's body was brought to the palace and Mandodari wept over him, she said, "Oh Arya Putra." I showed this to Karunanidhi also. Now, this was the fact which has been completely forgotten. Of course, today we can't modify and reform the Varna. Jati doesn't matter. It is mostly used for families. And ultimately, it also has no blood significance. Over the years, coming years, we should have a movement to slowly identify ourselves as nothing but Hindus and leave caste completely outside. There's one more thing that is called minoritism, which he mentions in his book. And that is pandering to the minorities. Well, there's no harm in accommodating what is called an affirmative action in America, minorities. Give them scholarships, give them special considerations, special tutorials, no reservations, but other things you can give. So we need, therefore, to start getting our act together, because with this media, this globalization, these opportunities, this materialism that has come into our system, corruption, we are targets. The Hindus are under siege. India's unity is under threat. We have to now build a new Indian whose identity is clear and who understands the true history of India. And then where we have a tradition, we are 100% Hindus. Parsis came, looked after them. When the British left India, they told the Parsis, "We can give you reservations in Parliament like the Anglo-Indians we have given." The Parsis said, "The Hindus have looked after us for thousands of years. You go, don't worry about us." The Jews were persecuted everywhere. We looked after them. The first resolution passed after the creation of Israel was, "Thank you, India, you are the only country in the world which did not persecute the Jews." So I don't have to explain to anybody as a Hindu that I can accommodate everybody. But when it comes to nation building, let us be clear, there are forces working to break up India and they want to see balkanization. It's not that countries haven't broken up. Soviet Union has broken up into 16 countries, Yugoslavia into 4. Indonesia is also, they had a small piece which got cut out. There are constant efforts to see that countries other than the dominant Western Christian ethos break up. So India is also under target. India is a threat. India is a bigger threat because our concepts are now being accepted by the Americans. But we, if we have our mind clear, then we'll not be victims. And it is towards this end this lovely book has been written. The next book is even better. And I'm sure that when he writes the history book of India, it will be even better. Thank you.